Hello guys and welcome to the Pro Dota Cup Series Season 9 by Azubu TV, SEA region, and we have a best of 3 between Beyond Infinity and Rex Regan Kaon. My name is D Swordfish and I'll be casting this game for you guys today, taking you through the wondrous lands of the SEA Dota. Right, BI versus RRQ. We have the first game going to RRQ. And rather convincingly, frankly. The stand-in did not work too well for Beyond Infinity. Their usual coordination was not there. And since their drafting is not stellar to begin with, the coordination, you just put them even below other teams. Sadly, Beyond Infinity will thus not be able to show us the true potential here against RRQ. But there's a lot on the line right now, which is... I mean, if you lose this best of three, you're out of the tournament. So they really have to put everything they have on this final game and try their most confident of strategies. They even tried a Dragon Ranger last time. They were really confident in Dragon Ranger. Usually Blizzard plays Dragon Ranger, and it's a fantastic Dragon Ranger. Sadly, doesn't seem like they can get Blizzard in today. Don't know if that's because he was kicked or he left or because he just has internet issues or school or whatever. Point is, Beyond Infinity will now be trying out the Shadow Demon instead. Let's go right into the draft, right? We have a Battler and Drow Ranger banned out by Beyond Infinity, interestingly enough. Don't want to give the first pick to RRQ. Axe and Mirana banned out by RRQ. Sanking and Faces Void picked up by RRQ, whereas the Shadow Demon has been picked up by Beyond Infinity. Shadow Demon, quite good against Faces Void, but not always good enough. Against the Diffusal Blade Manta build is particularly amazing, as you can actually use the illusions within the Chrono to actually hit the Faces Void and even stop in most situations. And you can use the Disruption to save most heroes, honestly, with a defensive disruption. Quite fantastic. You're up against a Sanking as well. Can easily evade Burst Strikes, or can even stop a Sanking from channeling. And that's not bad either. But for now, RRQ seems to have a much more solid draft, picking very strong laners to begin with. A mid or off lane Sanking, or even support Sanking, which would work out for them. Strong initiation and teamfight with both Sanking and Faces Void, and both magical and physical damage. So right now they have a good amount of a mixed and versatile lineup. And they can run Faces Void carry, they can run and then Sanking off lane, Sanking mid, Faces Void off lane, Sanking support, Faces Void whatever the fuck you want. It's fantastic. It's really good, because then you can't really try to lane against them. And that's what Beyond Infinity tries to do often. Right. Second pick for BI. What are they going to grab here as their...
Tidehunter.
Ooh, offlane Tidehunter. Interesting. Nice. So, the Tidehunter will be picked up as the second offlane for Beyond Infinity. Weak against Faces Void because the Chrono cannot be dispelled, obviously, and easily killed in addition to drained of his mana within that Chrono. The Ravage is good and gives you a lot of teamfight potential. Good combination with Shadow Demon 2 with the Anchor Smash plus Disruption. Usually you can get 1 or 2 hits out of that. And a strong laner. However, as second pick, maybe a little bit too early, as that usually means that you're leaving aside a lot of picks that could have been much better. Come to mind the Oracle, the Kunkka, for example. And I would not be surprised if they picked up a Kunkka regardless for Beyond Infinity. Shadow Demon plus Kunkka, you know, good combo. Tidehunter plus Kunkka, surprisingly good combo despite the rivalry. And Kunkka's particularly good against Faces Void. However, Beyond Infinity hasn't picked much Kunkka, and that might be why they might just not be able to play him. So, that's another thing to consider, which really not consideration. If not, RRQ can very well pick up the Kunkka with another support. And say Kunkka Oracle, for example. So a powerful combo. With the Faces Void, you destroy anything in the Chrono because of the Torrent. You even have the Torrent and the Boat, sorry. You have the damage resistance from the Boat, which is fantastic. On top of that, a good amount of area damage. Stops the Tidehunter easily with the X marks the spot. Counters the Shadow Demon. If RRQ want to pick it up, that would be a fantastic pickup for them. Now, the ban for BI, if they don't want to pick up the Kunkka themselves, should be the Kunkka. Unless they're afraid of RRQ picking up something different. I guess a Storm. Fine, okay, fuck it. Ban the Storm. Why not? Storm seems somewhat dangerous. Doesn't seem too great with a Faces Void and Sanking, but I guess it can be the cleanup crew for your team. Since you don't know what lane the Sanking is going to go on, I think they're assuming too hard that the Sanking is going to go support or that the Faces Void is going to go carry. Where we've seen Sanking mid before, and we've seen RRQ specifically playing Sanking mid. And, you know, all it takes is just to study your teams a bit. Now, let's see what RRQ is going to pick up now with the third pick. You can go for a big combo, or just a bit of buffing. Ogre Magi works fine. Honestly, as the roaming support, Kunkka still seems like a better option. But fine, Ogre Magi still buffs the Void. You can go for the buff strat again. A strong support. They're more confident in him than the Kunkka again. These teams... Oftentimes, teams really falter in the fact that they are not able to they're not able to play certain heroes, which would be, go better with the lineup. We've seen Warriors Gaming do the opposite of that, so it's quite fantastic in that regard. That's why they're winning this tournament. Beyond Infinity, now with the Invoker. Okay, we haven't seen a Beyond Infinity Invoker in quite a while, but Quaz Wex Invoker would be fantastic. Quaz Exhort would be a little bit worse, but with a Shadow Demon, it's a good combination. So with a Tidehunter, a lot of area damage in general, good Sunstrike combos early on. You can still pick up a lot of heroes that combo with the Invoker. Like, come to mind, Nyx Assassin, for example. Nyx Assassin actually would be quite nice as the second support with Shadow Demon. Nyx Assassin and Invoker combo is nice. Beyond Infinity has picked up weirder drafts. Shadow Demon and Nyx Assassin is a magnificent combo. Works pretty well against Faceless Void with the Burrow and with the Spike Carpus in general. Vendetta works nicely against Sanking and... just Sanking, really. I don't know. Nyx I'd like. Let's see what RQ pick up, though, against the Invoker. And this will be defined whether Sanking will go... what position the Sanking will go in and what position the Faceless Void will go in with this last pick. Because it's still uncertain as to what they want to run, right? They can still run another carry, they can still run another offlaner, they can still run another mid, uncertain, another support, perhaps. I still think the Oracle seems like a good idea. Oracle with the Faceless Void is a good amount of damage. And Oracle saves you from the Invoker damage in general with the Fate's Edict. Can really crush things with Yogur Magi as a early combo. We saw it last game, and the Oracle did pretty fine, honestly. It's not like Beyond Infinity played the Oracle badly. In fact, he was the biggest detriment to RQ's draft, or RQ's strategy, rather. Now, 20 seconds to go. Let's see what RQ's gonna pick up. They're thinking of themselves. Maybe the Invoker caught them by surprise. Lena. Oh, shit. Alina? Must be Lina support. That hero has not even picked at TI6, that's how terrible it is. For people wondering why Lina is a bad hero right now, is because of the Infused Raindrop. The Infused Raindrop makes her such a weak mid, and Lina support has been phased out for quite a while. However, they could be playing Lina support, and it works out. Honestly, with the Faceless Void is fine, Sanking, good combination, good amount of team damage. It's alright against the Shadow Demon. Stop the Tidehunter with a lot of burst damage, which is what you want against Tide, especially burst magical damage. Her BAT reduction is fine, I suppose. Morphling with a Beyond Infinity. Wow, okay. The Morphling is also another good pick. Against Faceless Void, against Lina, destroys him completely. A good combination with Shadow Demon. Destroys Sanking. Alright, the Morphling, I see. I mean, there's not much synergy between Beyond Infinity right now. Mainly the Invoker Shadow Demon is the main synergy they have. Maybe to some degree Invoker Tidehunter. But they have a good amount of counters to the enemy team. Invoker's fantastic against Void, so is Morphling. Lina doesn't seem to do much. I guess she's alright against Morphling, though, with the burst damage. But the Infused Raindrop makes her so weak. Let's see.
Earth Spirit.
Okay, Earth Spirit. Yeah, sorry. I was thinking... what? They're missing another... okay, Beyond Infinity bans on another support. That being the Ancient Apparition. Okay. Think if it's a Void carry, Sanking off lane Lina mid. Could be. And I would not like to see Lina mid. Against an Invoker? Doesn't seem like that strong of a pick. Let's see. What would be the pick mid lane? I would rather see something in a situation like Phantom Lancer actually looks fantastic.
Slark.
And Slark. Okay, they're going to go for Slark. That's fine. In fact, you can run Slark carry, Faceless Void offlane, Sanking mid, or Slark mid, Faceless Void carry, Sanking offlane. Depends on how much you want the Void to be, or how powerful you want the Void to be. Considering he's the only Diffusal Blade carrier you have the whole game, it's fine for the Void to actually be your main... it's fine for the Faceless Void to actually be your main carry. Because you can go Diffusal Blade early plus Montastel, and taking away the mana from the Morph is one of the most important things to do. Because if you do that, then he can't Morph in the Chrono, right? I mean, it's pretty obvious. I don't know why I'm explaining myself so much. It's just... yeah. Sorry about the this happens every single time. The SCS server's been fucking terrible, usually. With a new UI, I believe, there's a lot of resource issues. Resource management issues. I am waiting for a spring cleaning update so this stops happening. But luckily, we'll get back into the game, so don't worry about that much. There it is. Oops. Okay. Got it. So we're back into the game, no problem. We'll draft this off. All is good. And it is going to be a Lina mid? Why is he having to be playing the fucking Lina? Oh, no. Sanking support Lina mid. Ugh. Ugh, that's not that good. That is not that good. Actually, fuck it. I mean, the only issue is that two supports being melee, pretty weak, especially against an Earth Spirit and a Shadow Demon and a Tidehunter? But the BAT decrease in Lina might make her a proper carry. I don't know. I want to see how they play Lina, maybe. Okay, I'm not going to judge this time. Okay, RQ might know what they're doing. I know what they're doing. Let's see. Let's put some teams real quick before... Okay, hopefully there's not an initiation here. Void's going to play a little cheeky play. There, it's not going to happen. Right, so first of all, my name is D-Swordfish. I'll be your caster for today. Let's look into the teams. Sheffer will be playing the Sand King in the support position, interestingly enough. Ogre Magi will be the second support as Varish, obviously. The carry will be P-Sang on the Stark. Faces Void in the offlane, played by Sodak and Bira. And then Lina in the mid lane, played by Yabby. With a special set, too. Which is nice. The Immortal, I think. Immortal? The Wonder Woman Lina. Now, for the enemy team, we have on Beyond Infinity, no chance on the Morphling in the carry position. The Shadow Demon will be played by the City's Bug, going on the Varish, but yeah, hard kill. Didn't time the Rolling Boulder right. X-Files will be playing the Earth Spirit in the other support position. Meanwhile, Swifty will be playing the Invoker in the mid lane, and then Tidehunter in the offlane as about the side. What is interesting about this is that they actually rotated no chance, a usual support, into a carry Morphling, meaning that I can only presume X-Files is an Earth Spirit picker. Haven't quite checked his Dota buff, should have, maybe, but he is an Earth Spirit picker. Just assuming. Because if you do pick the Earth Spirit, not the most picked hero anymore, you particularly change one of your supports to carry, you have a stand-in, it might be just one of those Earth Spirit spammers, or a really good Earth Spirit player. But he did miss the Rolling Boulder. There it is, though. Let me go on Solo Gambier. This is them they're gonna hit. Hard to kill the Faceless Void without a stun, or some sort of silence. We'll see his plays later on in the mid-game. Right, then Lina should be able to dominate the lane early on, and she really needs to take advantage of this early on domination. Because as the game goes on, trust me, with the infused raindrops, it's going to be really hard to play. As look at this Varige being really slowed down with a poison herb too. Playing very aggressively, but the ignite plus the damage in the Void can actually bring down X-Files. It has no Rolling Boulder, and Void is continuing to harass him. There it is. One last hit, time block. They can't actually kill him because the Tango is giving him enough life, so the Gambir will turn range for a quick second and manage to get the kill. Sunstrike will come out. It will hit him. And now the final hit from the waveform will finish out the Void as the Shadow Demon also goes down. So two supports for one off laner. Not the best trade for Beyond Infinity, but not the worst either. Good Sunstrike by Swifty there. Hitting the Void. And yeah, please, Yabby needs to take advantage of this early game really efficient, or really a lot, actually. Just because the infused raindrops will come out, that'll cancel your harassment by a lot. Will make you as powerful. They might even grab Hood later on. Pipe is definitely gonna come out of the tide this game against Lina. But early eggs will make her damage pure, so that's also another reason why you might want to go for Lina. I do want to see that BAT change if seeing if it affects her too much. If you guys don't know, recently her BAT was changed from 1.7 to 1.6, making her the superior BAT. Much about Jug and whatnot, right? And that, for those of you that don't know what BAT means, that means basic attack time, or basic attack animation, essentially. Well, not really, it's actually not the same thing, but basic attack time is part of the formula that makes attack speed better. But a guy with lower BAT means that they can have more attack speed, so Fiery Soul is much better, and oh, Faceless Void could go down here to the Shadow Poison. You have to use it, but he heals up just in time with a magic stick, and that Shadow Poison is actually only level 1, so it's not going to kill him off anyway, but... It was a good attempt regardless by them. Meanwhile, in this mid lane, P-Sang going to Batasai. They're going to keep harassing him with a sensing and a double damage rune. However, Batasai, a hard kill, honestly, can dispel this pounce. Or should be able to dispel this pounce. Kind of show. There it is. A bit too late. Kayon, or P-Sang has the pounce. A couple more seconds for it. Oh, for two levels of Essence Shift. Okay, that's good. Now, X-Files. Yep, that's it. No way you can escape this. Rolling Boulder all you want. Yeah, you're dead. Sure, Lita did not have her bottle, so she didn't have much of mana, but she still deals enough damage to artifacts and one life cycle rate. That's life cycle rate, though. Okay, going for two levels of Essence Shift to harass the Tidehunter more in the lane. That's fine, I suppose. The value point in the Essence Shift, but it takes away a lot of damage from the Dark Pact, which you want to max as soon as possible. And you really want that Dark Pact pounce maxed as soon as possible, so you can have both escape and a good amount of damage. But at the same time, Slark relies a lot on the early good lane. So if he's having troubles with a Tidehunter and wants to harass him on the lane a lot more, still seems like Dark Fight would be a better idea, doesn't it? Yeah. Level 5, let's see what he grabs. Maybe he gets a second level of Pounce? Oh, second level of Dark Fight, okay. Why is Dark Fight better? Because the Anchor Smash gets dispelled by Dark Fight, and you really do want to do that, and you can harass the Tidehunter a bit more. Usually the Essence Shift will be fine if you're up against a really strong laner, say Axe. But all those really strong laners tend to be weak against magical damage, so Dark Strike will be a bit better. Now Sheffer in trouble. Well, not really, because the Rolling Boulder's not going to come out, and the Burn Strike is available. Can't quite use it. No Disruption Illusions almost kill off the Void. So I have to go back to pace. Ogre Magic keeps ganking this mid lane. And they're taking advantage of this early game as much as they can, but as you can see, now that the Infused Rain Dumps are out, and the lane is starting to lose in terms of last hits. They got a couple kills on the Void, on the Invoker, though. That's important. Nice Rock Ray comes in, so is Dragon Slave available. Have to use it as soon as possible. Swifty in trouble. Yabby with a Sunstrike, gonna get hit pretty hard. The Rolling Boulder comes in, and Express Delivery from X-Files as he brings down Swifty. Now, they tried to kill, sorry, bring down Yabby. Swifty, not gonna die here as Varish does this Air Spirit with a great mobility and an amazing gank. Kills them off in the early game. You see the power of the Infused Raindrops and why Lina's not run mid anymore. That's why it's not that great. Because the Ignite doesn't deal enough damage, it's completely blocked. That's extra 65 damage is usually very useful. The Dragon Slayer doesn't really stop it, you don't have damage over time. And any nukers is really brought down by that power of 120 extra. You can buy as many as you want, too. You don't buy the sticks on top of each other, but you buy them like... The refresh rate for them is easy, so you can easily buy them now, you know? And you're fine. You can buy, keep one on you pretty much the whole game. And cancel 120 damage from Lina, which is pretty big considering she's supposed to be a nuker. And Lina usually just barely has enough damage to finish you off. Oh, Lacuna Blade is available though. Careful. And Shovers are lagging ever so slightly. Now Slark with the level 6. Shadow Dance is gonna help him out a lot in this lane. Dark Knight should have come out here a bit earlier. And Shadow Dance. Sunstrike not gonna hit, so Pisang should be alright. Still has a pound, supposed to fight X-Files. The Ogre coming in. And the Anchor Smash still hurts him quite a lot. No Dark Knight being used just yet. Yeah, Slark. Careful, man. Careful. You're playing with fire there. In fact, so much fire that the Shadow Demon is coming in as well. Rolling Boulder, gonna see you, Slark. They know where you are. The Boulder Smash too, but X-Files almost goes down thanks to that Dark Pack. The Shadow Dance triggering and healing him up best he can. Slark still wants to evade being seen. Lurking in the shadow. Shadow Poison missing him. Battle Sigh. Is he gonna be caught out by Pisang? There it is, the pounce. Dark Pack as well. No stun though. Rolling Boulder comes in and they do miss it, but Dark Pack has not been triggered just yet. And they don't get the kill because of that. Would I say conservative Dark Pack usage? Perhaps. Conservative Dark Pack usage to some degree. No. Oh, no. Never mind. Thinking that no chance was gonna kill off the Void, perhaps, with a waveform come up, it's like, yeah, it's just important. You don't have any levels of Death Strike. Going for the Lincolns first. I don't see the point of the Lincolns this game either. What are you planning on blocking? Dragon Slave is not blocked. Laguna's played. Actually, yeah, Laguna's played. Okay, fair enough. Never mind, I take it back. That's why you're getting the Lincolns. Makes sense in this game. Strats come out in the Slark. Okay, that's... Look at the net worth, actually. Morphling is farming much better than Slark is. In fact, trades are coming up pretty late. The Tidehunter seems to be having a pretty easy time against the Slark. Even though the assets are pretty even for most of them. Yeah, it's pretty even. So I guess the difference is not that big. It seems like a lot because of the early game. Hasn't been able to get many kills either, but Slark does depend a lot on getting a decent lane stage. However, now that he has the ultimate up, he should be fine. He should be farming pretty well. X-Files gonna go down to one last Laguna Blade. He was stunned out, trying to get a Boulder Smash, couldn't quite do it, and yeah, caused that eventually. Good thing about, or bad thing about Lincolns is that Chrono's really effective against Lincolns users, because you know, it's an area stuff. But at the same time, the Morphling does not care about the Chrono whatsoever. It's really hard to stop the Morphling from morphing and they don't have any silences at all. So if the Chrono comes out, I don't know what the goal is. In fact, oh, see, Chrono comes out, but no chance. A lot of burst damage, though, surprisingly. Lina's gonna help out. No Laguna's Blade. The Burst Strike is available and will kill him off. Only level 2 morph is not enough to keep him up, and that's the issue. Levels of the morph missing. Yeah. So the Chrono is still pretty strong against him right now, but as the game progresses, obviously, he morphs much quicker. Which makes me wonder if the Orchid is not a good pickup, or if the Orchid would be a good pickup on Yabby. They have the Laguna's Blade, and I guess it's the goal winning the Chrono. Stop him in, can't wait for him, Laguna's Blade, kill him off. But at the same time, you rather not do that in the late game when Morph has a lot of strength anyway, if this does go into the late game. Because if it's Slark and Avoid, you can actually easily take this to the late game. You're fine. Oh, Sunstrike, and a hit so they can be here, but oh, that combo is not good enough as the Time Walk allows him to just Time Walk the damage away. Just backtrack it all. And Yeah, so maybe an Orchid would be a nice option. Again, utilizing the extra PA2 on Alina. Gonna be useful. Let's see, how does she rank against other heroes? I know... just wondering. Huh. She's up there with... I mean, she's not as good as the Juggernaut, but she's up there with the Huskar, the Wind Ranger, the Troll Warlord. That's bad. That's not bad. That's interesting. But the Terrible Blade has better BAT, the Wind Ranger, Huskar... Eh. That means why the Queen of Pain is built as a physical carry sometimes. So I guess she joins the Queen of Pain in her ranks. That's interesting. I just it's a good change. Definitely helps Alina out. Also, Dark Path is a good way to evade the Infused Raindrops, since a lot of takes the damage, I have to block a couple. Actually, maybe the Infused Raindrops don't block the Dark Path on second thought, because it's a two limit damage. Per tick. See, side with a bounce, taking away a lot of its stats, but without the Shadow Dance, it's not really safe to go in. Even though Dark Path did take away his Anchor Smash, the Dark Path is very dangerous to use in the early game when you have really low health. So you have to constantly keep the treads up at strength, and you're missing the mana, and yeah, not too great. Meanwhile, the Ogre Magi is trying to get that early level 6, or well, get a level 6 eventually. And the Earth Spirit has been quite in the crush in this early game, as he's only level 3, now finding level 4, trying to use the mid lane similarly as the Ogre Magi for experience. But they can find him and kill him super easily right now, as the Laguna's Blade almost destroys him. A combo of Dragon Slave and Laguna's Blade kills him right now, as Laguna's Blade deals 450 magical damage. You know, that should be enough. I always think of Finger of Death, because both of them deal 450 damage, except one is magical and one is just pure. Because Finger of Death, if you don't consider magical resistance, it kind of deals 450. Right. If you do consider magical resistance, sorry, it deals 450 pure damage, quote unquote. Cool. Just math. Just pure math. Let's see. Sotomon Gibeira is could be an easy kill with a waveform to Sunstrike combo, and it seems like that's what today's bug is planning. But at the same time, in this mid lane, they are going to pick out X-Files. They have an Epicenter. The X-Files is there. I can say finish him off. In comes the Ravage. Hits two. Hits three, actually. As the Ogre Magi is just nicked at the end. But they want to go on to Sanking. Burst Strike. They're moving down. One easy kill, and they all move away. Using the extra movement speed from the Lina, using the Burst Strike for the Sanking, and just Ogre Magi's good position. In addition, Bloodlust level 2 to give the extra movement speed, and I like that Bloodlust build. Helping out Alina quite a lot. Oh, they catch Swifty and Zeddy's Bug in that Corona. They have Laguna's Blade. Zeddy's Bug is going to go down really soon. Doesn't quite use it just yet. And Yabby might go down before he can use it. Goes down to the power of the Earth Spirit. As that's what the Gibeira does kill off the Shadow Demon regardless. But that's after a really annoying disruption. Ogre Magi goes down in the backline similarly. And there's no TP on this Void. Placing the move downstairs. Or down to the bottom lane downstairs. To where the Slark is farming. So he's going to be okay. Slark is this protection spell right now. He's been able to recover a lot of farm, which is good. But similarly, the Lina went back in terms of net worth against the Invoker. Invoker's fighting. That's not really good. Now, Hedra's coming out of the Void so they can actually get the Vlad. Yabby being caught out, full snap, plus a stun, silence. Yabby can't do much, no Yosef to help him out here, and can't even get the Laguna's Blade off, or the combo off, I suppose. Wasn't gonna kill our Spirit anyway. And with that, Beyond Infinity put themselves at the lead of this game. Quite convincingly, so. Look at that. Big lead for Beyond Infinity now. Big lead. They also have a solid late game with a Morphling and same Invoker. Oh, P-Zang is going hard on no chance. And a Shadow Dance still, so he's gonna be okay. Hard to kill him. In fact, he's gonna commit to this. I'm gonna go on Zeddy's Bug, realizing it's not the best of options, and just stays back. Goes back to the tower. With a Soul Catcher, you can dispel that with Dark Pact, which again, don't know why they're not doing this much. The conservative usage of Dark Pact here seems a bit weird, because they don't have many ways to actually stop them. So don't really know what the point of that was. It's a really low cooldown spell, too. Still, Sark needs the Shadow Blade or some sort of initiation item so he can actually start and hunting heroes mainly, the Invoker. That being the main hero that he wants to hunt. We need an Orchid or something to hunt the Invoker, at least Dust, to best case scenario. Now, P-Zang, being slowed by Demonic Purge. Can he... be helped out, though, by the Bloodlust, and... Okay, I don't know why that didn't deal damage to this one. That was weird. I guess he just healed it up really quickly with the Shadow Dance. That's fine. Now Pisa goes back to lane. Kills up, goes back to lane. Takes a couple hits. And can pounce out. Sunstrike will come out. That's a lot of burst damage and the silence. Dark packs it just the last second, but one last hit by the Shadow Demon will do the trick. However, that Rolling Boulder missed and thus put him in a really dangerous position. Catches no chance at X-Files in the middle of that Chrono. X-Shepherd wants to initiate, has the Burst Strike available, doesn't want to commit it just yet. It is a bit too dangerous. The waveform to evade the Life Strike Array. Now Zeddy's Bug in trouble. Laguna's Blade will come out, and that will finish him off with a Ravage. Counter initiation after counter initiation. One last Life Strike Array. Double combo. The Burst Strike, not enough mana, but they will kill off the Morphling. Maybe in time, no chance of morphing best he can. And that morphing to strength is making him so dangerous. Now, Shepherd onto Battle side. He has the mechanism, so he's probably not going to go down. They keep stunning him. Chain stunning after chain stunning. And he will end up dying even with the mechanism used. No chance can make it out alive in the end of that engagement, but they lose a lot regardless. And with that, that was a weird fight. Stark does die in the early game, but they get 3 kills in exchange. Not bad at all, as an Invoker kills off the Stark with a Sunstrike. Shit. Wow, that was... Okay, Stark was, again, playing really dangerously, and they caught him easily with the Rolling Boulder, and the Geomancer to grip. That's the issue of the disruption. You can't really prepare for that, right? It's a great setup stun for the Stark. Not always can you actually use the Dark Pact in time. I don't know if he should be smashing Q a bit more. But that's mash it hard. There's a couple times where I thought, yeah, he should have been able to get a Dark Pact. He just didn't. For some strange reason. Maybe got a little cocky or thought it was going to pounce. Maybe he doesn't understand the Dark Pact dispels. Maybe he's not a usual Slurk player. That's just stupid to say. Right. Invoker onto... Stupid on me to say. Invoker with the Travels, and Midas is doing pretty well in terms of net worth. Lina herself with the Water Center, and they catch Varish easily. They have a stun, and that's what it is. Okay, the Yo-Yo misses. That's pretty good, but Varish will go down regardless. Invoker deals way too much damage without Alacrity. And, yeah. Ignite, good stuff, but Sunstrike... Oh. I was gonna say, Sunstrike could still be used here. It still morphed it, that Tornado. Just in case it did try to get away. Yeah, perfectly fine. Now... Was he thinking of going on to... No chance, and with the help of maybe some sort of initiation? Because no one here is gonna help him out. In fact, the Abbey is already going down in the bottom lane. And... Starting in Vira, trying to catch Zeddy's Bug, but does not catch Swifty with the Chrono in time. Episode comes out, and he's gonna catch Swifty, who just barely walked into the Chrono. Starting in Vira has been silenced, but wants to kill X-Files regardless, will do so, as the Mantis starts to bring him down. The time walk, right on time. Ha, pun intended, saves his life now, walking into the trees. Will he make it? He will make it with a time walk. The Ravage doesn't quite hit him. The Dark Pact used efficiently. And there's the Shadow Dance. Pisang wants to get the kill onto this disrupted Shadow Demon. The Burst Strike onto Swifty. Shepherd receiving a lot of damage from those Lava Surges. And Shepherd will end up going down to one last orb from the Invoker. However, they do kill the Shadow Demon. And they still want more. Battle side being time dilated. Pisang still hiding in the shadows. Might want to initiate onto no chance. Not gonna do so. Now let's see, Beyond Infinity. Wants to get some sort of counter kill here, but right now it's just wasted time as the Lina comes back, and that's what they were waiting for. Lina's ready, Yabby wants to initiate, has the Laguna's Blade available, but no Yol Scepter to actually start the fight, and with that, the fight will finally disengage, perhaps? I mean. Seems like Beyond Infinity still thirsts for Lina's blood, but at the same time, behind them is a void with a bloodlust. It's kind of hard to use. No disruption coming out, so no clear initiation, and in the end, Beyond Infinity will finally disengage us. Invoker already swapped to the top lane, started getting more gold. He had the Sunstrike rate already anyway. They're going to be fine. And RQ is starting to move as a unit. The void is actually getting a lot of farm, which is, you think, to their advantage. Using the void more as a carry role, and then Stark just as a ganker kind of thing. Well, not really ganker, that's not really a role, is it? But Stark catching out the four supports, mainly the Shadow Demon and whatnot. The issue is that in this game, every time I look at it, it just seems like the Orc would be fantastic on the Stark. If you catch out the Invoker, you can't kill him because he's going to use his Wombo combo onto you. If you catch out the Earth Spirit, Rolling Boulder, if you catch out the Shadow Demon, Disruption, if you catch out the Titan Hunter, well, you're not going to catch out the Titan Hunter, it's not going to die. And also the Morphling, it morphs away, whereas the Orchid completely crushes all these people. Sure, the Orchid does not stop the Lincoln, so that Lincoln's going to be a pain in the ass, but still, you can catch out anyone else. And It's not the most common of items in the Sark, but it's also not the worst either. Similar to a Klinks when you grab an Orchid, Sark plays in a similar way. And oh, in they go. Good for Earthstrike. Sunstrike misses. Laguna's Blade. And there's the Chrono. The TP will TP right into the Chrono, but they have one help. The teammates. X-Files goes down already. Swifty in trouble. Interruption couldn't quite help him enough. And the Sark is really committing to the Shadow Dance, though, is going to be wasted in that Tornado. Dark Pact to evade the Tornado damage to some degree. Or Tornado stun to some degree. And so the Gambier is still coming in from behind. There's a... Oh no, the Amp is here with a Burst Strike available. Hits Zeddy's Bug almost entirely, but that's only two parts of the Amp because that Burst Strike came a bit too late. And they didn't time it properly. Ravage comes out. At least the Sark wasn't caught out, but Yabby was. The Waveform will finish him off, and you're Varisian trouble with the Dark Pact. With the magical damage from the enemy team, enough to finish him off. Now... I mean, that Beyond Infinity gets another team fight thanks to that Ravage. Amazing initiation. And again, does not seem like Lina's doing much this game. Seems like running the Lina in the mid lane wasn't that great of an idea. RRQ. And it's just punishing them. Honestly, that's just cheeky and annoying what I just did. But it's just punishing them. They heavily punished them for Lina. They have a really good pick in the Morphling. Fantastic pick in the Morphling. Because the Morphling is doing so much magical damage, burst magical damage constantly. He doesn't even have his E-Blade, but now with the Linkas, it's so hard to catch him out. And with his constant Morphling, what are you plan on doing anyway? Especially because the best thing about the Morphling with the Shadow Demon combo is that he can actually replicate himself. Because you can actually replicate the Shadow Demon Illusions. And you can use Illusion spamming to a whole new level with a replicate. You have to consider a replicate. Okay, not gonna morph. Let's wanna see. Okay, they wanna kill this replicate. There it is. I mean, committing to this pretty hard. It deals 80% damage. That's not bad at all. When you start getting stats, in fact, I wouldn't even recommend the E-Blade build. Go for the stat build and go for the illusion kind of morphling. With what Manta style and with. Which is another way you can get the morphic illusion, by the way. So it's not only the challenge. You can Manta style, you can get the Scotty, you can get Butterfly later on, and you deal so much damage, and you even have Illusions dealing a shit ton of damage as well, plus slowing, it's fantastic. Now let's see. Roshan. In trouble, Sunstrike. Roshan is in trouble because of they have a good amount of armor. That means easy, or armor reduction. With the Four Spirits, man. And Power Needle. Now, Blink Dagger on Sobek and Fear, that's going to help a lot in terms of initiation. And they have finally surpassed the Titan in terms of farm, which is fine, but the gold is still definitely in Beyond Infinity's favor. However, the big thing about this is the gold has not been completely in their favor. You know, it's 21 minutes in, it's still around the 3,000 mark. RRQ is not farming badly. They have a Shadow Blade on the Snark. The Echo Saber will come out very soon. That's going to help him a lot. And then Lina has a Yule Scepter for better initiation. It also makes her much safer of a target. She's even grabbing a Aether Lens to help her out in team fights, not die, you know, to get a fight from behind. I want to have a Blink Dagger, something of the sort, or just an Agonist plane. Plane just Agonist. Now, again, after the Echo Saber, would love to see an Orchid on the Slark, but it will make him a bit too scrawny, I guess. Easy to kill. Epicenter coming in, gonna catch that, no chance. They can't stop. No way! The Replicate was out, and they didn't seem to understand or know. Had they waited a couple more seconds, maybe they would have done the trick, or the Chrono coming in first instead of the attacking Burrow Strike. And they didn't see the Lincolns in time, the Inkling was available, they could have done a variety of things to start out the Morphling, but in the end they couldn't. Sure, he could have morphed out of the Chrono anyway, and would have been a hard kill regardless, but they had the Laguna's Blade available, plus a Yule Scepter, plus, you know, the Replicate only had 7 seconds left. They could have caught him out really easily, but the initiation was ideal. They were a bit too cocky there. Would not be on the thing, was powered up on him. As well, actually, RQ takes the tower down up top. Well, the Slark does a bit of creep skipping, very smart. Prevents the enemy team from taking this, I guess. All you have to do now is clear the lane. And his Yabby is with him with an Eagle, that should be fine. Oh, Guardian Gates to keep the Eagle alive. And they really want to take these racks. As they know the Slark is not here, so they can take advantage of this now, taking on the first range racks. Can they do it? And good stuns coming out, but. The backup protection is just not triggering anymore. What the fuck? This is just space for like a good 7 seconds or so. Even though the creeps were there for a good 7 seconds. They should have cleared the lane a bit quicker. Maybe. Nah, they couldn't really. The backdoor, or the weak creep skip that they did with the Swark was not effective. As a result. Unfortunate. So Sorakabir's gonna go for the Fusel Blade himself. Before Monta style. Seems fine though, honestly. It's not like you're gonna have to evade anything in the enemy team. There's not many things that the Monta style will help you against, and the Illusion Spam is not effective against a Disruptor. Shadow Demon anyway. Yeah, Echo Saber's good on the Slark. And the Fusel Blade will help you a lot against Morphling anyway. Oh, he's sad. Finds a Slark. Okay. Grabs the double damage room instead. Has a Shadow Blade and an Echo Saber. That's gonna hurt if he finds any sort of support. Which is why Beyond Infinity should just stick together for now. And wait for the double damage room to pass out. Jeffer almost caught up by the Invoker Tornado. As the Slark proceeds to farm a bit. Okay. Yeah, I realized it was gonna last. While in the bottom lane, they do catch out the Void. Just X-Files using the Geomantic Grip and the Boulder Smash. Really quick. Now, Pisang has the Shadow Blade. Onto no chance. Will catch him, but I don't think enough damage. Is even a replicate available for him. In fact, Morphling wants to kill the Slark himself. Shadow Dance available. Now the replicate will come out, and Pisang again fooled by that replicate. They want to defend this tower. They've already lost Bot and Rax, and they want to go for the mid ones as well. I don't know if it's that smart to go in that quickly. Swifty in trouble, the epicenter not coming out. As he just perfectly blinks away, but with a good epi, I guess he just fighting against a Ravage though, that's the issue. And in comes the Rolling Boulder, they want to kill Yabby really quickly. Yosef will take away any sort of silence that he had on him. And the Lifestrike Array, he's pushed away, but the Lifestrike Array does stun him out. And he's gonna go down as they do kill off the Sanking Morphling. Good kill there. The gem is available too. Let's start the raid. Morphling still very dangerous. Where is the Slark helping him out? There's the Chrono. Finally, the Slark comes from behind. Swifty would be the better target, but they just don't want to go in. It's at the Aegis. And the Ravage comes in. So does the combination from the Invoker. Meteor pulls Deafening Blast. Slark fighting out, but Slark will only bring out the Aegis from the Invoker, so they can't do much there. And now the tower starts going down. The Range Rax is all they want for now. Easy kill. Ogre Magi in trouble because the Yulceptor is too powerful. Yabby comes in with a combo again. Yulceptor up. But the best counter to Yulceptor is your own Yulceptor. And he doesn't even use it. He uses it a bit too late. Ice Wall is slowing down considerably. The tornado hits Yabby still. And they want to kill this Lina. One more blink will do the trick there. It is Morphling with the Adaptive Strike. The E-Blade of the Pisang. And the Sunstrike barely misses. Geo Chance evades the Burrow Strike because of the Lincolns. Want to go on to Sheffer. Has the E-Blade and Waveform available. Sheffer, only a couple more hits will do the trick. He's really trying. Can they see this? No, they can't. And meanwhile in this mid lane, Pisang, blocked back. Not caught by a tornado. It is very dangerous though. Slarky Slarky gonna go down to the power of the Four Spirits. And that's a dieback. GG comes out in RQ. And there will be a third back. They did find their golden Earth Spirit, I guess. Their golden boy. Better standing here. And with a fantastic job by No Chance here being a good support or a good carry. And a good game also by the Earth Spirit allows them to win this matchup. Even though they weren't playing. I mean, they didn't win by that much, but they just played really aggressively. I like this because RQ before was playing insanely defensively, and that was not the best because they actually lost a lot as a result. However, and they almost, I mean, they didn't lose the game, but they didn't do too well. Beyond Infinity was playing really badly last game, but now they play well. Like I said, they had a lot of potential. And as you can see, look at the Morphling kills. They all killed the Slark, especially the Invoker killed the Slark twice. That was pretty big, considering the Slark should be killing the Invoker, not vice versa. Even Zed's Buck killed him a bit in the early game. X-Files not getting many kills, but getting a lot of assists. With 8 assists, and even 8 deaths, actually recovered pretty well. And Swifty not dying a single time, getting the Midas early, dominating the early game. Frankly, the Lina pick was just not that great. Look at the player net worth. I just want to see the. Oh, shit. Oh, wow. Is it only a Tinker player, Yabby? Fuck. Jesus Christ. Anyway. I just want to see the lead up. There she is. Yeah. There. See? Lead net worth compared to, say, Swift. God, fuck. Compared to, say, Swifty. As you can see, Swifty completely beats Lina every time in the mid lane. And the 5-minute mark, by the way, around here, that's the Infused Raindrop. That's when it comes online. And look at the difference now. Invoker beating, it's starting to beat by a bit. Lina recovers in a team fight and then starts to skyrocket. With a minus 12, which got around 10 minutes in. That minus was huge, too. You can't really do much. In terms of player level, this is actually similar. I don't know if I can do the same thing. Oh, I can. Oh, it's already good. There, okay. Can see 5 minute mark, and Invoker's already beating her by quite a lot, but the 5 minute mark around here, you can see that the Invoker's already winning, thanks to the Infused Raindrop around this area, and then the Midas just makes him skyrocket at minute 10. Easy. Alright, that's it. My name is Bindi Swordfish. Hope you enjoyed the cast. If you didn't, feel free to tell me why, but with actual words, not like fuck it or Mr. Maggie TV. And we'll be back soon with the last game of this best of three. Who decides? Who loses and who will have to exit the Pro Dota Cup season number 9 SCA region and who advances to the next round of the losers brackets. I'll see you guys soon with the next game of the day. And until then, guys.